Hi, this is the Chem 138 Final Exam Pinocchio Lecture. We are going to start off. Let's let it load. It takes a second to load here. We're going to start off with talking about what is organic chemistry. And let's turn on the pen here so we can. Okay, so first of all, when we describe organic chemistry, we are describing carbon-based chemistry. Carbon-based chemistry meaning that there are molecules that have long chains of hydrocarbons with functional groups hanging off of those. Those different functional groups are prioritized and numbered on the carbon chain, and we identify the carbon chain by how many carbons we have and which functional groups might be present. Remember that organic chemistry is based on covalent bonding chemistry, meaning that the bonds, that the electrons are shared between the nonmetals in order to gain an octet. Okay, when the electrons shared, they can be shared evenly in what we call a nonpolar bond. Okay, or the electrons can be shared a little bit unevenly in what we call a polar bond. Nonpolar bonds, if we were to take the electronegativity difference between the two different atoms that are contained in the bond, we would find that they would be less than 0.4 in electronegativity difference, while in a polar bond, the electronegativity difference will be between 0.4 and 1.6 in electronegativity difference. If it's higher than that, it will be considered ionic. And that in that situation, the electrons are pulled so tightly towards one entity and pulled away so much from another entity that they are just formally charged either positive or negative. The one possessing the electrons would be the negative charge, and the one lacking in electrons would be the positive charge. Now, when we look at a polar bond, it has some of those characteristics where we have one pole of that molecule, P-O-L-E, being a very negative pole while the other is a very positive pole. And because of that, when we look at intermolecular forces, I think I have to get used to this pad again. Intermolecular forces, there are four major intermolecular forces that we can contend with that attract particles in a population between each other. So the attraction happens between the particles in a population of them. And the strongest, of course, is ionic interactions, while there's the second strongest would be what we call a dipole-dipole interaction, specifically the hydrogen bonding interaction. Hydrogen bonding is something that happens between something that has an HF, something that has an OH, or something that has an NH on its particle. Okay, and it's the dipole-dipole interaction that occurs between the hydrogen and the fluorine bond, where the fluorine has more negativity and the hydrogen is lacking in electronegativity, making it slightly more positive on one side and slightly more negative on the other. And then when other particles are in the mix with it, its positive side will orientate itself next to the negative side of a neighboring particle. The other is just simple dipole-dipole interaction. The same description that I just mentioned for hydrogen bonding, it just doesn't happen between those specific atoms. Okay, it doesn't have to be a hydrogen and something bonding. It's just a electronegativity difference within the particle that causes a dipole, and the dipoles will set themselves up so that the positive end of the dipole will be near the negative end of the dipole of a different particle. Okay, the last is the Van der Waals attractions, and Van der Waals can be described as a population that starts to create a polarity within the population. For instance, all the positive charges are tucked into these multiple the multiple molecules stacked up against each other, and the outside is very negative. So we have positive and we have negative, and it has a polarity between the population. Okay, let me just check myself. I have a list here that I'm going through to make sure that I cover everything that will help you guys out on the final exam. And it looks like for this slide, we've covered everything. So let's move on. Okay, when we talk about, hold on just a second, my transition's not very good with this particular one. When we talk about organic nomenclature and structures, we have to be aware that it's on that prefix-suffix system. I'm not going to go through the prefixes and the suffixes. You need to look those up. I went over a lecture on it for the laboratory, and it will be under the module that says for lab students only. Go into that module, pull up the lab on nomenclature, and there will be a full lecture on the different types of nomenclature if you're still confused on it. What I want you to be aware of is to make sure that you locate the longest chain of carbons for the main chain name, and that you prioritize the functional groups. Remember that if a functional group has a high priority, it'll probably change the main chain name. For instance, if you have an aldehyde, the particle will end in AL. If you have an alcohol, it will end in OL. But if there happens to be an alcohol and an aldehyde, then you will end it, if you have an alcohol and a carboxylic acid, which is the highest priority, the ending name will go with the carboxylic acid due to the high priority. The first carbon will be numbered at the carbonyl carbon of the carboxylic acid. So keep in mind that you need to understand how to prioritize the functional groups, and that priority list was given to you again in that nomenclature lab in that packet. The last page of it has a chart that goes from carboxylic acid all the way down to halogens and priorities that tells you the order in which they are prioritized. Okay, when we look at the nomenclature too, we have to be aware of isomers that might be present, for instance, cis or trans isomers. Cis meaning that you have two hydrogens that are fixed on one side of a non-rotating bond, while a trans meaning that you have two hydrogens that are fixed on opposite sides of where that non-rotation is compared to the median plane of that particle. Remember that particles themselves will take the lowest energy conformation, and you need to be aware of that when you draw out a cyclohexane ring. Isomers are where we have different forms of the atoms, and they're constructed differently. Some isomers are only constructed geometrically in space differently. Some are constructed so that their atoms are connected to different atoms, and other isomers are considered stereoisomers, where they are constructed in space around a central atom in a different way. Okay, when we talk about constructional isomers, as it is in this question from your packet, okay, it's asking you to draw all of the different isomers that are possible for C6H14. So we could, of course, and those are expected to be drawn in the linear fashion, okay, meaning that you're drawing the endpoints of all lines are carbons, and the necessary hydrogens that would give them four bonds are then assumed. When we look at this molecular structure, we already know that they're all single bonds, because the formula for figuring out saturation levels is 2N plus 2 if they are all single bonds, N meaning the number of carbons that are present in that hydrocarbon. And since 6 times 2 is 12 plus 2 is 14, we have 14 hydrogens. That indicates the full saturation level. That means we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 carbons. Okay, we could also construct it one, two, three, four, 5, and 6, okay? We could certainly put a methyl group on the third carbon rather than the second carbon. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And on the third carbon, we have the sixth carbon, okay, hanging off as a methyl group. Let's see, what else could we do? We could, well, that would be the same. Oh, excuse me. We could put two methyl groups off of the terminal carbon. Okay, that would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And we could put two methyl groups as functional groups and make it a butane. Okay, and so on and so forth. So you may be asked to do these on one of the fill-in questions, so be ready to be able to draw all the different constructional isomers that might be present on that particular atom. Remember that if the saturation levels weren't so that all of them were single bonds, you would have a different formula. If you have 2N, that would mean that you had one level of saturation. Okay, and that would mean that there was one double bond present. Every time that you subtract two hydrogens from the mix, that means that your level of saturation has gone down and there's another double bond or triple bond present. Okay, so let's look at the nomenclature that you've been assigned. It says, please draw 4,5-diethyl-6-methyl-dekene. Okay, so this indicates here that we have two ethyl groups, okay, and they fall on the fourth and the fifth carbon of a dekene, okay, and the ene, of course, represents that there is a double bond present on the second carbon. Furthermore, there's a methyl group on the sixth carbon. So let's go ahead and draw a dekene. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. We'll number it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. So we need to put a double bond on the second carbon. On the fourth carbon, we have an ethyl group. So that's two carbons. And on the fifth carbon, we have an ethyl group. And on the sixth carbon, we have a methyl group. And we are completed at that point. Okay? A benzene is alternating double bonds on a six-membered ring. Okay? And on this, it's telling us that on the first and the third carbon, we have chlorine. So a chloro group on the first and the third carbons. It would be proper to draw in the lone pairs of electrons. Okay, but you don't have to. I won't grade you down for not having that lone pair of electrons. Okay, here we have the di represents that we have two alcohols on a main chain that has six carbons, as well as an ene. There should be a dash right here, by the way. The ene indicates that there's a double bond on the fourth carbon. I prefer for myself to put the number that describes the functional group right in the middle of the chain. IUPAC standards, you can put it before the word, or you can put it right before wherever the functional group is described. I prefer right before the functional group is described because it's easier to keep track of everything. So we have a hexene 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. I'll number them. Okay, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Okay, on the third, we have a methyl group. Okay, on the fourth, we have an ene. Oh, goodness sakes, sorry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. On the third, we have a methyl group. 1, 2, Okay. On the fourth, we have an ene group. And on the first and second, we have alcohols. Sorry, this pen is really difficult to draw a straight line, so you'll have to excuse the messiness. But your final will look like this. The mistake that I almost made in this was that I started to draw the double bonds starting at the third carbon. You always start the double bonds on the number that is listed and put the double bond, and it goes through the double bond. So it goes four through the double bond to the fifth, okay? Octanoic acid, you'd have eight carbons, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, okay? And if there's no number listed for carboxylic acid, then you know that it's already on the terminal end. So we put a carboxylic acid. I put it kind of upside down compared to what you're used to probably, but there you go. Remember that this is the very first carbon always. The carbonyl carbon is always the first carbon that you list. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. You have all of your carbons there present. Okay, benzoic acid is just something you should know because it's a very common organic molecule. Benzoic acid would have your carboxylic acid off of the first carbon of the benzene group. Okay, now the orthopara meta nomenclature describes that ortho means that two functional groups will be one neighbor away from each other. Okay, para will be two neighbors away. So these will be one carbon away. Okay, a meta will be two carbons away from the two functional between the two functional groups, and a para, let's just put it over here, and a para will be three carbons away on a benzene ring. So this has a phenol, meaning that it has an alcohol on the first carbon of a benzene. Okay, that's the name for a phenol. So you automatically draw the phenol, that will be the first carbon. And para to that, there's a methyl group. So we go ahead and put a methyl group in there. Very good. Okay, it says, please draw 1,3-dibromocyclohexane. Okay, and this could be either drawn in the cis or the trans. So first you have to draw a cyclohexane. Remember that the lowest configuration of a cyclohexane is in the chair position, where the two groups are where the front of this is kind of coming out towards you. Okay, and the back of the ring is going away from you. It'll just, the reason it does this is it tries to reach a tetrahedral formation. Remember that when you have the chair, that you'll have three axial positions, every other one with groups on it. Pardon me, I just realized that I did this wrong. Okay, let me do this over again. Okay. When we draw, I'm not going to draw in the shading right now. But when you draw three axial positions that are up, just every other one, and three axial positions that are down. My goodness, I'm having a real problem with this pen trying to draw it so that it's really showing what is going on here. Three axial positions down. Ugh. Sorry, that's supposed to be perpendicular. Three axial positions up, and then there's three equatorial positions. If you have an axial positions will be exactly vertical, okay, and equatorial positions will be tilted according to the median plane. The angle of the equatorial positions will be exactly like the angle of the cyclohexane ring one neighbor away. So this angle right here, and it will be down since this axial position is up. So if we have hydrogens on here, okay, then this will have an equatorial position up. This will have an equatorial position up. This will have an equatorial position down. That has down, so we have to go up on this one. And that would be a cyclohexane ring with no functional groups. Now, if you have a 1,3-dibromo cyclohexane, okay, in the cis position, then you would have a bromine on the first carbon and the third carbon in the cis position. Both of them would either be up in the equatorial or up in the axial position, or down, are both down. They just both need to be on the same side of the median plane. So I would put them in the equatorial position since they're so far away from each other. The only time that you don't put functional groups in the axial position for lowest energy conformation is if they are next door neighbors to each other, and the equatorial positions would be closer. But if they're next door neighbors and you need them in the axial, if they're next door neighbors, the farthest away you can get them is in the axial positions. So here we would have the bromines in the equatorial positions to have them in the lowest energy conformation. If we have a trans situation, you'd have one in the equatorial and one in the axial position. Okay, so this one is asking us to draw HEP1-ene and then ine. Okay, that means you have both a double bond and a triple bond present on the 7-member chain. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, well, I've already kind of drawn that incorrectly. We have to be careful because the ine that starts on the third carbon, it will need to have its carbons coming straight out from it because it's linear. So this will be the second carbon, this will be the third carbon, the fourth carbon, the fifth carbon. So we have to draw it like that first, and then we can draw the first carbon coming down from it, okay? And that one has an ene on it, okay? And then we would draw the sixth, the seventh carbon. Okay, and that would be how you would draw that. Remember, this portion is held rigid and linear because of that triple bond being present. When we look at 3-isopropylhexane-1-al, that's an aldehyde on the terminal end of that hexane. Okay, aldehydes always show the carbonyl group and the hydrogen, and this will be the number one carbon. Okay, so we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and there's an isopropyl group present on the third carbon. So off of here, we have a propyl group. Iso means same, meaning same on both sides of the propyl. That means that we have one carbon coming off here, one carbon. So this propyl group is 1, 2, 3. That is an isopropyl group. Sometimes it's easier to use the common names rather than the IUPAC system. This is the only thing, these iso, tert, and T-butyl are the only recognized common names that are used in the IUPAC system and still recognized as being beneficial in nomenclature, because it's harder to name this as an ethyl methyl group than it is to name it as an isopropyl. So we do recognize those. As far as naming isotert and T-butyl in the functional groups, they are not, they do not affect the nomenclature except iso. All right, so here we have, please draw R-bromo-chloro-fluoro-methane, okay? The easiest way to draw a chiral compound, meaning that there's four different groups around one central carbon, is to start in the center and draw your lowest functional group going away from you. And this has a bromine, a chlorine, and a fluorine. So you go with the lowest. Oh, and of course, it has a bromine, which is AMU-wise, this is 79 AMUs, a chlorine, which is 35 AMUs, it has a fluorine, what is fluorine? Fluorine's the lowest, though. I don't know the offhand what the fluorine is. I just know that it's lower than these two halogens. And then, of course, you have one hydrogen, which is one AMU, okay? So this would be first priority, this would be second priority in chirality, third priority, and this is fourth priority. So you put your fourth priority going away from you in the dashed position, okay? And then put your first priority in the wedge position coming out towards you. Okay? And then consequently, draw your second and your third in such a way that it will cause it to be either clockwise or counterclockwise. Ours, you want to be clockwise, so that it goes from 1 to 2 to 3 in the clockwise direction. So clockwise is this way, right? So we want to put the second group in, which is our chlorine, okay, here. We want to put our third group, which is our fluorine, here. And that will give us the R configuration, okay? The enantiomer for an R configuration is going to be an S configuration. So all we need to do in that situation is just draw the same thing, okay? But we're going to flip the F and the Cl, and we'll have the S configuration, okay? So this one shows we have priority one here, two, three. If we follow it around, that is going in the counterclockwise direction. If we follow this around, one, two, three, we follow it around, we end up in the clockwise direction. Okay. Can our bromofluoromethane have a diastereomer? No. Diastereomers require that you have two or more stereocenters, which is also means chiral centers, present on the actual molecule. Okay, cis and trans isomerization across a double bond requires a couple of things. You need to first have a double bond present, and secondly, you have to have, okay, hydrogen and some other entity or on that same carbon. This right here would be an example of something that does not have cis-trans isomerization. Okay, you can't have two of the same atom on one side of the double bond. Okay, here's CH3. This one, on the other hand, has a methyl group and a hydrogen on that carbon, and a methyl group and a hydrogen on that carbon. Therefore, since the two hydrogens are exactly opposite, on opposite sides of the medium plane, or the double bond here that's held rigid, we call that a trans. Okay? Okay, and then if we were to have a cis, it'd be something like this. Okay? So that you had both hydrogens on the same side of the medium plane where there's no rotation. Okay. Notice that we also talked about cis-trans isomerization on the cyclohexane ring. And that is because on rings, you don't have rotation on the bond. With cyclohexane rings, however, you can have cis-trans isomerization on the neighbor next door, like you would with a double bond, or two neighbors over, or even three neighbors over, okay? Because there's no rotation between those two entities, if that's the case. Okay, let's talk about hydrogenation. Hydrogenation would be where we added H2 to, let's see, 2-methyloctyne. Okay, so we have 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 2-methyl. Oh, I did that again. So let me fix this. Let me erase it. I told you to start with the triple bond, and then I didn't start with the triple bond. Okay, so here we go. So this is carbon 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 7 and 8, okay? And if we were to react this with hydrogen in the presence of a catalyst, the catalyst has to be there, okay? You will reduce that those two pi bonds, okay? So if you have a triple bond, you'll reduce it twice. If you have a double bond, you'll just reduce it once. Basically, what's happening is that the double bond is disappearing, okay? Because the hydrogen is replacing that double bond, and you'll end up with just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Okay? So you end up having the double or triple bond disappear, and it's replaced by hydrogen. Just kind of think of the hydrogen as like lunar landing on top of that double bond, and as the double bond breaks, the hydrogen-carbon bonds form. Okay, so we have 2-methyl octene this time. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. And on the fourth carbon, there's a double bond, okay? And we're adding HOH across that double bond in the presence of an acid, okay? And all you're thinking of, just think of that HOH coming right over the top of it, and as the bonds form with the H and the OH, the double bond breaks. So you'll end up with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. So between the fourth and the fifth carbon, you're going to have the water add across that double bond. Okay, the most likely scenario is that the alcohol will add here and the hydrogen will add here. Okay, the alcohol adds after a carbocation intermediate is produced. So there's a positive charge in the intermediate of this reaction occurring. Cations are more comfortable on tertiary carbons than secondary carbons than primary carbons. Okay, in fact, sometimes they will shift molecules around, even move methyl groups in order to have a tertiary carbon. Okay, but in this case you have more branching on this side, so my guess is that it's going to end up on the fourth carbon rather than the fifth carbon for the alcohol. I expect you to just write that an OH and an H add to the double bond and the double bond breaks. I am not expecting you guys to go into mechanics of reactions. Now, a hydrolysis, and I wrote this wrong on the practice exam. I think that I wrote, I don't know what I wrote anymore because I fixed it on here. But I had some sort of misspelling on it. Maybe I wrote hydrogenation or something like that. But this one says, please write out the reaction and predict the products when you have 2-methyl-4-octanoate. Okay, so... I just realized that I wrote the structure wrong. Let's just do a simple hydrolysis reaction where we have an ester present, okay? And forget about this. Sorry, I wrote that incorrectly. I'm looking at it like, what the heck is going on? I did it, this one I completely flubbed. Okay, so what you want in a hydrolysis reaction, you either want to have an ester or an amide that can have an NH here, and that will go through the hydrolysis reaction. What you notice when you look at the structure is that it has a really positive charge right here underneath the carbonyl group, and that leaves it susceptible to attack from either an amine, the lone pair from an amine, or the lone pair from an alcohol. Basically what happens is that those lone pairs will attack that area, and it will add to the carbonyl group, and it will break this bond, and you'll end up with this as the other portion of the particle. In other words, the particle breaks. Okay, so you'll end up hydrolyzing it. Okay, basically hydrolysis is used when we look at fatty acid hydrolysis. Okay, and this can be done either with an acid catalyst, so it can have an H plus catalyst, or it could have a base catalyst, a negative OH catalyst, okay? Base catalyzed hydrolysis will end up producing an alcohol and a salt, or a water and a salt, okay? So that's what we call saponification. Make sure you go back and review that reaction. Okay, oxidation reactions, what I want you to be able to recognize is the categories of alcohols That can go through oxidation reactions. The type of alcohol that can go through the most reactions, oxidative wise, in this class, although there's stronger oxidants that can do more that you won't learn in this class, is a primary alcohol, meaning that alcohol is connected to a carbon that is only connected to one other carbon. So when we do that, you'll end up with first an aldehyde, and it can go through a further oxidation to a carboxylic acid. If you have a secondary alcohol, meaning that the OH group is connected to a carbon that's connected to two carbons, and it goes through an oxidation, you will end up stopping at a ketone and you won't be able to go any further. Okay? Tertiary alcohols will not go through oxidation reactions unless you have a really strong oxidant, and that would be breaking the carbon-carbon bonds. Okay, combustion reactions are just hydrocarbons, okay, that react with oxygen, at least in this class. That's what we're going to call a combustion reaction in this class. A little spark of heat, okay, and you end up producing always a combination of CO2 and HOH or water, okay? The hardest thing in doing these is actually balancing the reactions. Here we have six hydrogens here. Here we have two hydrogens on this side. You would be able to put a three here, but it's better to keep the coefficients at an even number. So let's go ahead and put a six rather than a three and make this a two, okay? So on this side now we have 12 hydrogens. We also have 12 on this side. Here we've got four carbons, okay, so let's put a four here. Then at the end, once you do the carbon and the hydrogen balancing, go ahead and address the oxygens. In this particle, you have eight oxygens. In this particle, you have six oxygens. If you add those together, you end up with 14, okay, oxygens. If you cut that in half, that means that you would have seven here, okay? Always balance this one last. There was a couple of different reactions that you might want to take a look at. There may be a couple of multiple choice questions on dehydration reactions or adding dehydration reactions, meaning that there's an alcohol present on the alkane chain and the alcohol is removed to create a double bond. Okay, I'm not sure that there is that I will put any questions like that, but I may. So be aware that you need to look at all the reactions. These are just examples of ones that I could ask about. Okay, classification of alcohols and amines are important because we discuss them a lot in organic chemistry, in the reactions and the way that it behaves in its environment. So it's really important to understand how to classify them. Alcohols that are primary will be connected to a carbon that's only connected to one other carbon. So it'll only have one bond to carbon. Okay, it will also be, of course, connected to two hydrogens. Okay. A secondary alcohol, on the other hand, will be an alcohol that's connected to two carbons. That's connected to a carbon here, okay, that's connected to two different carbons. Okay. So it'll be in the middle of a carbon chain, not on the terminal end. Primary alcohols are on the terminal end. Tertiary alcohols will have even more branching off of that carbon that's connected to the alcohol, okay? So a tertiary carbon would have here, would you have three bonds to three carbons, okay? And amine can go one step further in classification because amines are classified by how many carbons the actual nitrogen is connected to. If you have a primary amine, okay, it's going to be connected to one carbon, okay, and two hydrogens. Okay, a secondary amine will have one connection to a hydrogen and two connections to carbons. Okay, while a quaternary amine will be connected to four different carbons. Okay, we identified this as a primary alcohol, a secondary alcohol, a tertiary alcohol. This is a primary amine, a secondary amine. Oh, did I forget a tertiary? I did. So tertiary is going to be a connection of three carbons, okay, to the nitrogen, okay? Sorry, there won't be a hydrogen on there at all. It'll just have a lone pair of electrons. And then once the lone pair of electrons disappears, it will become positively charged. So quaternariamines are always positive. Okay, structure recognition. Let's change the pen color here really quick. Okay, we'll have to excuse the noise in the background, but I just have to go all the way through this. Okay, this right here would be a benzene. Now, when we look here, so you would just write benzene on there. Okay, or a benzyl group is fine, if we want to call it a functional group. Okay, here we have both a ketone and an amine, a secondary amine, right? But if you have both of those right next to each other, you always go with the highest priority functional group that you can list. So you would neither name it a ketone nor an amine, but rather an amide. And that would be the situation here as well. This is an amide, okay? This is a thioester. I don't expect you to know thioesters. It just happened to be on this example, but I will give you some of the other functional groups that we've commonly talked about. And this, of course, is a carboxylic acid, okay? So you will probably get a little bit more complex molecule with more functional groups present, and you will have to identify where all of the functional groups are and circle and identify what those functional groups are. Make sure that I covered everything. Yes. Oh, furthermore, there may be a situation where I ask you a question. Okay, where I ask you a question, where I ask you to identify the stereocenters centers or the chiral carbons, okay? A chiral carbon, of course, will have four different groups around that particular carbon. So right here would be a chiral carbon because we have an amine, okay, a carbon connected to a sulfur, a carbon connected to a carbonyl, okay, and of course there's a hydrogen that hasn't been drawn in. So those are four different functional groups. Here, that's not, a stereocenter is not possible because you can't fit four functional groups, okay. Another chiral carbon would be here, okay. We have a carbon connected to a carbon that has a carbonyl group, a carbon connected to a nitrogen, a carbon connected to a carbon that has two methyl groups on it. So that has four different functional groups around that carbon. This is not chiral. This one right here is not chiral. Why is it not chiral? Because you have a methyl group and another methyl group. You cannot have two of the same functional groups around a chiral carbon, or it's no longer chiral. Okay, next we talk about carbohydrate chemistry, which is sugar chemistry, okay? Specifically, when we introduce sugar chemistry, sorry about my non-straight line. Let me see if I can try that one again. Let's see. A little bit better. Okay, when we talk about carbohydrate chemistry, you have to recognize that they may be talking about Fischer projections. Okay, Fischer projections are where you have the spine of the linear chain or the linear sugar that has the alcohols to the left and to the right of the to the left and the right of the this backbone, this carbon backbone. Okay, and then hydrogens on the other side. We always list the most oxidized carbon closest to the top. If you have an aldose, oh, I shouldn't have put a COOH, huh? I should have put a C double bond, OH, excuse me. Okay, so this is an aldose. Let me erase that and redraw it for you. Sorry. Okay, it's just that we only get one shot to do these videos. I'm going to do it straight through, so I'm just going to do my best. Darn it. Let's try this again. Okay, an aldose would have an aldehyde on the top carbon, which would be the most oxidized carbon. A K ketose, geez, I can't draw straight lines with this pen. Okay, a ketose, on the other hand, will have a ketone, okay, on a ketone, one, two, three, oh my goodness sakes, this is just getting worse as the... Okay, so this would indicate a ketone, okay? This would indicate an ketose, and this would indicate an aldose, okay? You don't, each one of these alcohols, or each one of these carbons that contain alcohols, and I'm just randomly doing this just to show you examples. Okay, each one of the carbons that are underneath the aldehyde or the ketone will be considered a chiral carbon. So each one of these is chiral. Okay, of course the last carbon is not going to be chiral because you have a carbon bonded to a hydrogen and two hydrogens. Let's see, two hydrogens and an alcohol. Okay, so when we identify or classify carbohydrates in the linear sugar form, we look at the farthest chiral carbon from the oxidation point, from the most oxidized carbon. Okay, so this one here, it has the alcohol pointing on the left-hand side. And remember that you can't move Fischer projections around. They have to stay stationary on the page. You can't, like, flip them around. So in that case, that's why this becomes... this is considered an L form, and this is considered a D form. D's have the last alcohol on the right-hand side. L's will have the last alcohol away from the most oxidized carbon on the left-hand side. Okay? So D's and L's. In nature, you will find D configurations to be the most prevalent. Okay? Just nature makes D forms of sugars most prevalently. Like Fischer projections, there's Haworth projections that are drawn for sugars where they show the alcohols up or down. Okay, when sugars close up, they'll usually have a carbon that's outside of the ring. This carbon right here came from was the most oxidized carbon. Okay, when the ring closed, this was the carbon that held the oxygen that was the most oxidized. So therefore, you start numbering from this carbon when you do sugar chemistry, and this would be the second, the third, the fourth, and the fifth carbon. And they use that same numbering system for the sugar in DNAs. Okay? Remember that when we have, so this would be considered a closed form or a monosaccharide form. Monosaccharides could also be in linear form, but a closed monosaccharide form. These sugars in the closed form many times link together to make disaccharides, polysaccharides, and oligosaccharides. Okay, disaccharides link together two of the more simple sugars, and I'm not going to have you recognize exactly what a fructose looks like or what a glucose looks like, but I do want you to recognize the bonding structure. So I want you to be able to recognize that a glycosidic bond, meaning a bond between sugars, is an ester bond that can either be, okay, pointing down according to that ring or pointing up according to that ring. If it is pointing down, as I have in this example, it's considered an alpha glycosidic bond. Okay? If it's down on both, it's considered this one right here, you'd start numbering here, right? 1, 2, 3, four, and then the fifth would be off of the ring here, and then one, two, three, four on that sugar. So this is bonding between the first carbon of the first sugar and the fourth carbon of the second sugar, and both of the bonds between the ester that frame the ester are pointing down according to the planes of these two sugars, because Haworth projections are specific too, just like Fischer projections, where you can't really move them around. Okay, so both of these are alpha bonds, and they're connecting at the 1,4. So we would call this an alpha 1,4 glycosidic linkage. You will either have to reproduce one of these bonds if you're asked, or you will have to be able to recognize them. If something were beta, let's say we have an alpha beta bond, okay, it would be pointing up according to that particular sugar. So in this one, it's pointing up, and this one is pointing down. So this would be an alpha beta 1,4 linkage, glycosidic linkage. Okay? Remember that sugars, when they come together, produce what we call carbohydrates, which is plant starches, including amylose or amylopectin, animal starches, which includes glycogen, or cellulose, which is a type of carbohydrate that makes a very solid construction. We're not able to digest cellulose. It will just go right through our body and act as fiber in our body and kind of flush us out and carry along some of the negative waste products that we need to get rid of. Okay, let's talk about drinking. I included drinking in the final exam material just because I find that it's really important to understand what a drink is considered. If you're talking about beer, if you drink 12 ounces of beer, it's considered one drink. That is, if the beer contains, if the beer for a 150-pound person brings that person's level to a .025 level. Okay, one for wine, you would only consume about 5 ounces to get to one drink. Okay, keep in mind that by the time that you get to a 0.4 alcohol level, okay, you can be at risk for a coma. Okay, so it takes quite a few drinks in order to get there, but that shows that when you drink in excess, that it is quite toxic. It's toxic at low levels. It's just that we're able to detoxify it with a biofeedback pathway in our body. But if that biofeedback pathway is too saturated with reactions, then and you overindulge, okay, you can end up really hurting yourself. So be careful with alcohol. It is a toxin in our body. Remember that by the time that you get to a 0.1 level, okay, you're legally drunk. Okay, and will be cited for drunk driving. Okay, let's talk about steroids. This is in another chapter. Steroids. Hold on just a second. Okay, steroids will have that typical ABCD ring, which consists of, this is what I want you to be able to recognize, that it has 2-3 cyclohexane rings. I always have to look at it when I first draw it, okay, but I want you guys to practice this and be able to either draw it or recognize it, probably recognition. Okay, you will see that it will have an A, B, C, D backbone on it. There's further things that we use to identify a steroid, whether it's possible, but I want you to be able to see that if you see this type of structure, that you know that it's a steroid. Of course, it'll have other things hanging off of it. For instance, this right here, let me finish drawing it. CH3, we have a CH3 here. And coming off of this one, we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, if you see this, Okay, this is what we commonly know as cholesterol. Of course, steroids are what we consider hormones, and they work with bioregulation and cell signaling. They help to appropriate whether or not we need to have protein expression or certain tasks need to be done in the body. Steroids are not the only form of hormones. There's also polypeptic hormones, okay? So don't think that just because somebody says steroids that it's the only type of hormones. There's also protein hormones. Well, let me make sure that I covered everything that I wanted to talk about. I know that in class we talked about testosterone, estrogen, HDL, and LDL levels. I won't make you memorize anything more than understanding what a steroid is, what it's responsible for, and how to recognize a steroid. Okay? There's a little bit more that we talked about in fats and waxes. Fats are esters, or carboxylic acids, depending on how they're attached, with long fatty acid chains, okay? Those fatty acid chains could be all single bonded, which we would call a saturated fat, meaning that it has as many hydrogens saturating it as possible, or we could have fatty acid chains, okay, that have one or more double bonds present. If we have one double bond present, it would be called monounsaturated. If you have more double bonds, it would be polyunsaturated fats. Okay, when you have unsaturated fats, meaning that the double bonds are there, and due to the fact that most of the time fats will be in the cis conformation, okay, they don't really make the same sort of shape as something that is saturated. Saturated fatty acids are many times integrated into things like cell membranes, into the glycerol phospholipids. They'll put a phospholipid head on this side of it and keep the fatty acid tail. And these offer a lot of flexibility in the fatty acid chain so that it can snuggle up against one another and create sort of a barrier to maybe aquatic environments or what have you, which is what happens with glycerol phospholipids. Double bonds being present, especially in the cis form, okay, are not used well in things like glycerol phospholipids because they have those kinks in them that do not allow them to snuggle up against one another and become solid, okay? And so when we have monounsaturated cis double bonds, they tend to be oils, okay, while we consider these to be fats. Okay, so oils like olive oil and so on and so forth, fats as in animal fats or the fats that come from coconuts. Okay, these types of double bonds, when you have a trans unsaturated bond, okay, they tend to mimic the shape of a saturated bond, and sometimes the body is fooled into using those in their glycerol phospholipids, in integrating them into the glycerol phospholipids. That is bad because these do not offer the flexibility that's needed in cell membranes, and so they can become dangerous and cause the cell to malfunction. So you want to avoid eating trans fatty acids so that that doesn't happen. Natural fats will have cis bonds. When we make things in labs, they tend to be trans for some reason. Okay, we need to find better enzymes or catalysts to make sure that we ensure that we end up with a cis. But right now, most of the time, you will end up with trans fatty acids. Okay, a triacyl glycerol. Let's erase what we have here. A triacyl glycerol will consist of a glycerol backbone, meaning that you have 1, 2, 3 carbons. Glycerol is a 3-carbon chain with 3 oxygens on it that have esterified with 3 fatty acids, okay, of whatever length. Okay, this would be an example of a triacyl glycerol. Many times you can make soaps from these fats. Okay, and that would be considered a base hydrolysis reaction, which we already covered. And remember that base hydrolysis, you will end up hydrolyzing this bond right here or breaking it. Okay, so the end result is that, let's change our pen color to red. Okay, you'll end up breaking the molecule here. Okay, and you'll end up with a glycerol okay, from the OH attacking these bonds, okay, you'll end up with a glycerol plus 3 units of sodium carboxylate salts, okay? This should say R on it. But this right here would be one of these chains, and you'll end up with 3 carboxylate salts, okay? And that's what we call saponification. So now you know that saponification takes place with fats, a lot of times from animal fats, but the fats could be any type of fat, even fats are fatty acid chains from oils. Okay, the more unsaturated you get when you do a saponification reaction, the more soft the soap will be until you get liquid soap. Okay? All right, so moving on into amino acids. Amino acids are the monomer that is contained in the polymer of protein. Okay, so you want me to say that again? If you see this, okay, this is what we commonly know as cholesterol. Of course, steroids are what we consider hormones, and they work with bioregulation and cell signaling. They help to appropriate whether or not we need to have protein expression or certain tasks need to be done in the body. Steroids are not the only form of hormones. There's also polypeptic hormones, okay? So don't think that just because somebody says steroids that it's the only type of hormones. Proteins are also, there's also protein hormones. Well, let me make sure that I covered everything that I wanted to talk about. I know that in class we talked about testosterone, estrogen, HDL, and LDL levels. I won't make you memorize anything more than understanding what a steroid is, what it's responsible for, and how to recognize a steroid. Okay? There's a little bit more that we talked about in fats and waxes. Fats are esters or carboxylic acids, depending on how they're attached, with long fatty acid chains, okay? Those fatty acid chains could be all single bonded, which we would call a saturated fat, meaning that it has as many hydrogens saturating it as possible, or we could have fatty acid chains, okay, that have one or more double bonds present. If we have one double bond present, it would be called monounsaturated. If you have more double bonds, it would be polyunsaturated fats. Okay, when you have unsaturated fats, meaning that the double bonds are there, and due to the fact that most of the time fats will be in the cis conformation, okay, they don't really make the same sort of shape as something that is saturated. Saturated fatty acids are many times integrated into things like cell membranes, into the glycerol phospholipids. They'll put a phospholipid head on this side of it and keep the fatty acid tail. And these offer a lot of flexibility in the fatty acid chain so that it can snuggle up against one another and create sort of a barrier to maybe aquatic environments or what have you, which is what happens with glycerol phospholipids. Double bonds being present, especially in the cis form, okay, are not used well in things like glycerol phospholipids because they have those kinks in them that do not allow them to snuggle up against one another and become solid, okay? And so when we have monounsaturated cis double bonds, they tend to be oils, okay, while we consider these to be fats. Okay, so oils like olive oil and so on and so forth, fats as in animal fats or the fats that come from coconuts, okay? These types of double bonds, when you have a trans unsaturated bond, okay, they tend to mimic the shape of a saturated bond, and sometimes the body is fooled into using those in their glycerol phospholipids, in integrating them into the glycerol phospholipids. That is bad because these do not offer the flexibility that's needed in cell membranes, and so they can become dangerous and cause the cell to malfunction. So you want to avoid eating trans fatty acids so that that doesn't happen. Natural fats will have cis bonds. When we make things in labs, they tend to be trans for some reason. Okay, we need to find better enzymes or catalysts to make sure that we ensure that we end up with a cis. But right now, most of the time, you will end up with trans fatty acids. Okay, a triacylglycerol. Let's erase what we have here. A triacylglycerol will consist of a glycerol backbone, meaning that you have one, two, three carbons. Glycerol is a three-carbon chain with three oxygens on it that have esterified with three fatty acids, okay, of whatever length. Okay, this would be an example of a triacylglycerol. Many times you can make soaps from these fats, okay, and that would be considered a base hydrolysis reaction, which we already covered. And remember that base hydrolysis, you will end up hydrolyzing this bond right here or breaking it, okay? So the end result is that, let's change our pen color to red, okay? You'll end up breaking the molecule here, okay? And you'll end up with a glycerol, okay? From the OH attacking these bonds, okay? You'll end up with a glycerol plus 3 units of sodium carboxylate salts, okay? This should say R on it. But this right here would be one of these chains, and you'll end up with three of them, three carboxylate salts. Okay? And that's what we call saponification. So now you know that saponification takes place with fats, a lot of times from animal fats, but the fats could be any type of fat, even fats or fatty acid chains from oils. Okay? The more unsaturated you get when you do a saponification reaction, the more soft the soap will be until you get liquid soap. Okay? All right, so moving on into amino acids. Amino acids are the monomer that is contained in the polymer of protein. Okay, so you want me to say that again? Amino acids are the monomers, the small units that are linked together via peptide bonds in a peptide chain that eventually makes up a protein. Amino acids have three main components. They have an NH group, okay, or an amine, okay, and that is connected to a carbon that is connected to what we call an R group, and the R group will be different for each amino acid, okay, and then that is connected to a carboxylic acid group, okay, so you'll have these three components. You'll have an amine, a carboxylic acid, and you'll have an R group. The R groups range. There's 20 different types of R groups or amino acids that you could have, okay? And the R groups range in characteristics from nonpolar to polar to basic to acidic to also aromatic amino acids. And those amino acids within the polypeptide chains will behave a little bit differently, attract different components, so on and so forth. For instance, if you have a very positive amino acid, it may attract a may cause the protein or the peptide chain to fold a little bit so that it can be near a very negative amino acid. Okay? So the amino acids themselves and the way that they're orientated help to define the shape of what that protein chain or the polypeptide's primary structure will be. Okay? Of course, we're going to go into the transcription, transportation, and translation of amino acids in just a bit. But keep in mind that the amino acids are specific. I want you to look at the amino acids and be able to recognize if you have a basic group, what's considered an acidic group, what's considered a nonpolar group, and what is considered a polar group. You will not have to reproduce amino acids by memorization, but you should be able to look and recognize whether or not the amino acid fits into those categories. That's what I expect. For the most part, anything that just has hydrocarbons in the R group is going to be considered nonpolar. Anything that will have carbonyl groups or nitrogens in it can be considered polar and may also be acidic. the most acidic, or what they call S. There's neutral polar groups, and then there's also acidic. Okay, acidics will have a direct carboxylic acid on the R group, while a basic amino acid will have an amine on the R group. Okay, so be cautious, look at those. Of course, an aromatic amino acid will have an aromatic component on the R group. Okay, so we specify them by the R groups. There's 20 different types of amino acids. Those are put along a polypeptide chain. Okay, and they help to control how the actual particle exists in its environment, how the peptide chain folds, how it reacts, what it does, its functionality, so on and so forth. Okay, do remember that the PI, or isoelectric point, helps to define if that amino acid is going to be charged or uncharged in its environment. If you get to a level where your pH is lower than the amino acid's PI, okay, then it will have a positive charge. If you have something that it has a more basic environment where the pH is higher than the PI, then it will be the opposite. It will be in the negative form. Okay, I think that's all I need to mention for this slide. And let's move on to proteins. Proteins are composed of amino acids that have been linked together in a particular form. So we have them linked together, and we have, you know, maybe a glycine, maybe an alanine, so on and so forth. They link together in a particular way and start to fold into different conformations. The very first classification of proteins, the very first structure that we look at, is what we call the primary structure of a protein. And that just tells us the order in which we find the amino acids. We have amino acid 1 here, 2 here, 3 here, 3, 4 here, blah, blah, blah. Okay, and we identify them with their three-lettered condensed names. But I'm not going to have you guys memorize those or anything like that. I will have you guys be able to recognize how to go from a codon to an amino acid translation, but we're going to go over that in just a minute. The primary structure is how the amino acids are placed in the polypeptide chain. Okay, when the amino acids are placed, they start to curl around or start to make what we call beta sheets. Those conformations, those secondary conformations of the proteins, how it curls around or makes the beta sheets, is what we would call the secondary structure. The secondary structure of that protein. So the two major secondary structures that you will need to recognize are the alpha helixes, okay, where the polypeptide chain starts to curl around in a coil, or the beta sheets, where a sheet starts to happen, okay, due to the fact that the amino acids are curling up and around and making a sheet, okay? So we call this a beta sheet, okay? Once the alpha helixes and beta sheets, you may have three alpha helixes in your protein chain and two beta sheets. When we describe how the alpha helixes and beta sheets are orientated in relationship to each other, we call that the tertiary structure. Okay, the tertiary structure is affected by five main types of attractions. Okay, that would be your salt bridges, your hydrophobic interactions, your hydrophilic interactions, your hydrogen bonding, and your disulfide interactions. So we have hydrogen bonding, hydrophobic, hydrophilic, okay, salt bridges, hold on, let me turn on the light because I think you guys are probably losing me now. Hydrophilic, hydrophobic, hydrogen bonding, salt bridges, and disulfide bonds. Did I miss anything? No. Okay, salt bridges, of course, happen between charged particles where you have a positive end and a negative end. Hydrophobic interactions are where the nonpolar entities or R groups try to group together to sort of repulse any aquatic environments. Hydrophilic, of course, would welcome that water and would be polar groups that are able to face a watery environment. And hydrogen bonding, of course, have R groups that can hydrogen bond that have OHs or NHs present on them. Disulfide interactions are where a covalent bond, it's not a very strong covalent bond, but it is a covalent bond that occurs between cysteines or the S groups in an R group. So there's a sulfur and a sulfur, and they bond together covalently. And it causes a change in shape of that particular tertiary structure. So the tertiary structure would describe how many alpha helixes there were, how many beta sheets, where the alpha helixes were in relation to the beta sheets, so on and so forth. Okay, when we talk about proteins, once that tertiary structure is formed, the tertiary structures, multiple tertiary structures usually come together to make a quaternary structure. Sometimes tertiary structures and quaternary structures are the same thing. A quaternary structure will usually be composed of two or more subunits of tertiary structures. So two or more polypeptide chains that are in their tertiary structure will come together. In fact, many times there's four subunits. And those subunits can be the same subunits or different subunits that are completely different polypeptide chains. Okay, once that quaternary structure is obtained, those proteins are usually classified into either globular, which are compact shaped proteins that are involved with escorting, with signaling, with synthesis, or they could be fibrous proteins that are involved with structure. They tend to be long linear filament type of structures that are involved with cell structure or tissue structure. A type of protein that is extremely important is the enzyme. If the enzymes were not present, okay, we would not have biological reactions happen. Enzymes are catalysts that are natural, okay? And they have what they call an active site in which a substrate or starting material, some sort of biological starting material, comes together, okay, and reacts. So this is the enzyme. The substrate binds into the enzyme and reacts with other substrates, okay? And once the reaction takes place, a product is released and the enzyme's released. You end up with your enzyme. So you kind of go, you have your substrate bind in, you get an enzyme substrate complex, okay? And then the enzyme releases the product, okay? Now, in order for enzymes to work properly, many times they have to have cofactors or even vitamins bind into somewhere in the region of the enzyme, okay? And then it becomes active. Many times it can't be active without that. That's really important that you have, that's why it's really important to have vitamins and cofactors or minerals present. If people are missing them, some of their important biological reactions have a really hard time going forward. Additionally, sometimes we target the enzyme for inhibition, or there's even natural inhibitors for enzymes. Of course, natural inhibitors that are produced in the body to keep the level of enzymatic action down to a minimum would be reversible inhibition. While sometimes when we target, let's say, organisms like bacteria or something, we can force irreversible inhibition where we cause their enzymes not to work and consequently the organism dies. Okay. Inhibitions can take place either competitively, where it binds into the active site and doesn't allow the substrate to bind in, or it can be non-competitive, where it binds somewhere on the enzyme, causing the enzyme to become inactive. And again, if it's irreversible or covalently binds into either the active site or another site, causing it to become inactive, then it can cause the fatal results for that organism. Okay. Do remember that vitamins that are used, we either have water-soluble vitamins or we have fat-soluble vitamins. The fat-soluble vitamins will include K's, A's, D's, and E's. Okay, so just remember that word. And you need to be weary of fat-soluble vitamins because they get stored in, when there's excess of them, they get stored in their fat cells and they can build up toxically and cause overdoses to happen. So you don't want with those gummy vitamins to be eating too many of those because you can have major results from that. As a result of it. The other type of vitamins are water-soluble vitamins where the excess amounts should be flushed out with your waste products. So those tend to not be terribly dangerous for you. Oh. Okay. When we talk about drug synthesis, many times we synthesize drugs, the organic compounds, that inhibit the that competitively or non-competitively inhibit the enzymes. See, also, I would like you to understand how enzymes work to their best ability through pH levels and through temperature levels, okay, where the optimum pH is somewhere around 7.2 or a little bit higher than 7, okay, for reactions to be at their optimum level, okay, whereas the temperature is around 37 for most enzymes. All enzymes are unique as far as what their levels are, but you should know these charts. You should also know that there is a point where the number of substrate that is available will start to affect the reaction rate of the actual enzyme. Okay, there's going to be a point where you're going to saturate the enzyme because there's only so much of it, and it will just maximize out at that point until the substrate starts to subside. Okay, so those graphs, if you'd like to review them, are figures in chapter 16, figure 16, 16, 16, 17, 16, 18. Be aware too that proteins can denature. Okay, and the denaturation process can happen via heat, agitation, or with pH levels. So you can change the acidity or basicity and cause proteins to separate out into their linear form or their primary structure so that they become unfunctional. Sometimes if you have denatured the protein gently enough, you can renature it back to its functional shape. But most of the time when you denature, it tends to be irreversible, especially with agitation or with heat. For instance, when you fry an egg, you can't get the egg back to the yolk. Okay? All right. Let's talk about DNA and RNA. In DNA and RNA, you need to understand the differences between DNA and RNA. DNA is deoxyribonucleic acid, okay? And guess what RNA is? Ribonucleic acid, okay? So we can already see the first difference between DNA and RNA. There is no, on the sugar of a DNA, there's no alcohol present that is present on an RNA. So we see here, DNA looks sort of like this. We have a phosphate. Okay. Oops, that should be an O. Okay, and then we have a base. So nucleic acids are composed of three major parts. They have a base, they have a sugar, and they have a phosphate. Nucleic acids link together via their phosphates. So this phosphate will connect to this OH of another sugar, okay, and it will have a base, so on and so forth. As far as how DNA puts itself together, the bases will, this will make a long linear chain, so we'll have a phosphate. A sugar for the next DNA, the next nucleotide, and a base. Okay, and then the chain will continue. So you have this phosphate backbone between the sugars. The sugars will connect to the bases, and the bases will hydrogen bond between the base of another polypeptide chain of nucleic acids. Okay, so this one will hydrogen bond to the base of another nucleic acid. This, of course, will be connected to to a sugar, the sugar will be upside down, okay? And this will be connected to a sugar, so on and so forth. Okay, so what you get basically is a strand, this phosphate backbone here of DNA. You get your bases that are hydrogen bonded between one another. Okay, and this would be one strand of DNA, this would be another strand of DNA. Remember that we number the sugar 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. This is what they call the 5 prime portion of DNA, and this is the 3 prime. So one of these strands goes 3 prime to 5 prime, the other strand goes 5 prime to 3 prime. You can look that up if you don't understand it, because I can't spend a lot of time describing that. Now, a DNA will not have an OH group here, and DNAs in general will be double-stranded, just like I showed here. You have one strand, you have another strand. RNA, on the other hand, will have this OH group here, okay, and will not be double-stranded. They'll only be double-stranded for very, very small amounts of time to get complementary base pairing, to get a message, or to take the codon to the anticodon and the codon together. But in the most part, the most of the life of each RNA particle will be in the single-stranded form, okay? So DNAs are different because of that oxygen on the second carbon. Okay, they are also different because DNA is found double-stranded, RNA is found single-stranded. Okay, the other difference is that these bases can be composed in DNA of A's or adenines, T's or thymines, G's or what we call glycines, or cytosines, which is C. Okay, if you have a RNA, the bases are A's, U's. U's and T's are almost the same. It's just that U's are missing a methyl group, and G's and C's. Okay? So when you base pair, when we do what we call complementary base pairing, A's will always complementarily base pair to T's when we have DNA to DNA. And when we have DNA to RNA, they will complement with A's to U's. Okay, or use to A's. C's and G's will complement on both. Okay, so C's always C's will always complement and hydrogen bond to a G, and A's will always complement and hydrogen bonds to either a T or a U, depending on what we're comparing to. Okay, so now we have to kind of get to what is the story of DNA, RNA, and proteins. Okay, and really what the story is that all of the information that we have, all of the recipes that we have, are contained in the DNA, specifically in the genes on the chromosomes. Each gene is a recipe for the different proteins that we express in our body. And as we've learned, the proteins are pretty much responsible for everything that happens in our body structurally, escort-wise, enzyme-wise, signaling, all kinds of things that happen in the body are activated by proteins. Okay, so proteins are a very, very important component. And therefore, organisms have found that the recipes for these proteins are very, very important and need to be safeguarded. In eukaryotic organisms, in fact, they are safeguarded within the nucleus. Okay? In the nucleus, there's really only two things that happen. There's the opening of the DNA, there's synthesizing DNA for DNA. There's transcribing DNA in order to make proteins, okay? And there's RNA synthesis in the nucleus. We're going to specifically talk about the transcription process that happens in the nucleus. So we have the nucleus, and within the nucleus, we have transcription take place. When there is the need for a protein to be expressed or synthesized, the cascade of signals will come and eventually open up the nucleus area of the DNA, open up the DNA, and find the gene responsible for the recipe for that particular protein. opens up the DNA, a polymer will attach to the DNA and start to make a complementary strand of RNA that we call messenger RNA. So the messenger RNA will have the complementary strand to the original DNA. Okay? Every three bases on the message will be considered a codon. Okay? Once the whole message is what we call transcribed, so it's written down, scribed, okay? Once the whole message is transcribed, it will be transported outside of the nucleus to a ribosomal area. So we'll call this a ribosome right here. Ribosomes are also composed of RNA, single-stranded RNA, that make up a large unit and a small unit. The message is then fed into the ribosome, okay? And as the message feeds into the ribosome, it will identify the different codons and pull down a transfer RNA that has the complementary anticodon to that codon. And on top of that transfer RNA, there will be an amino acid, okay? So the ribosome is responsible for taking the message and the transfer RNA, bringing them together so that the transfer RNA can drop off the appropriate amino acid. This amino acid is dropped off in the process, okay, and a peptide bond is formed between it and the next amino acid that gets dropped off, okay? So eventually, as the message gets fed through, you end up with amino acid and amino acid and amino acid until you get this long polypeptide chain of amino acids, okay? And we call this process where the transfer RNA drops off the amino acids, we call that the translation process. Now, what will you be expected to be able to do? I expect you to be able to look at the codons on the genetic code and determine what, if I give you a series of, if I give you a message with several codons on it, you need to be able to recognize that every three base pairs will be translated from the genetic code to each individual amino acid. So I may give you a message and then you'll have to translate it to what the amino acid chain would be. Okay? It's that easy. It's quite fascinating. There are several YouTubes that you can go to where it shows the how fast that the translation process works, and it's quite amazing. And they're interesting to watch. So I do suggest that you go and look into that. Not for the test, but just for your own personal knowledge. I also want you to be aware of what the stop codons are and what the start codons are. Stop codons stop the translation process. Start codons start the translation process. Okay? I hope you guys do well on the final exam. The final exam will consist of true, false, multiple choice, and a fill-in portion. Okay, I know that there's several things that we went over during the semester that I didn't necessarily focus on for the final exam material, but I'm trying to give you the broadest amount of information that you are able to remember and apply to other classes through this organic chemistry class. So I hope that this helps. And good luck with the test. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to write me an email and I will try to get back to you as soon as possible.